Hi everyone, this is Caroline again with you with Thriving Abroad, our expat interviews, and I am so happy to be in the company of Miss Jasmine Lancaster. She's living her best life in Japan, and we're going to talk to her and see just how awesome life is there. Konnichiwa, Jasmine.
Hello.
So nice to have you. So first of all, how did you get to you're in Sapporo? Are you still there? Are you in Kyoto?
Yes, I'm in Sapporo. I vacationed to Kyoto, but yeah, I'm living in Sapporo, which is on the northern island of Hokkaido in Japan. So I've actually been living in Asia now for a year. So before I lived in Japan, my big move abroad was to Thailand. So I was there for 6 months before I moved here to Japan. I've been here since April.
And did you move there for school? Were you taking a class, or did you just have that on your bucket list of places to visit and live?
Yeah, so kind of all three. So I'd always really wanted to go to Thailand. It was just kind of, I don't know, I felt like it was planted in my head to go there. At the time, I was living in Washington, D.C. I'd been living there for a year, working at a tech job in D.C., and I really wanted to go abroad. I knew that at that age, if I made a career change, that I'd kind of get, I get stuck in that cycle, and I really wanted to experience living abroad before I really went all in with that. So I was in conversations with a company, and I was actually going to do some international consulting in Africa, and the training was 6 months. So they were like, if you move abroad for 6 months, do this training with us, and then you can come, do these contracts in Africa and continue to live abroad. So I was like, okay, great. So I made the move to Thailand. And what I did is I got a TEFL certification. So I got a TEFL certification in Thailand. I did a 4-week program. And after that, you're certified to teach. And so to kind of pass the time while I was doing this training and having a little bit of income, I took a TEFL class. And so, yeah.
So you're teaching English now.
Yeah, so okay. I did that in Thailand for 4 months, and then COVID happened, and so basically it was really crazy, and I couldn't go to Africa, I couldn't do the consulting job, and so everything kind of got turned on its head, and then I met someone in Thailand, and we decided, he really loves Japanese culture, he's a digital nomad, and we decided to move to Japan, and so now I've been living here since April, and yeah, as far as if we get into this kind of stuff, but visa stuff versus Thailand and Japan is very different. And so it was a process if you want me to go through that too.
Interesting. So it really wasn't on your list. I mean, when you were younger, did you say, oh, one day I'm going to go live in Japan. I'm going to go live in South Asia or the Far East.
Honestly, no. Like, to be honest, this was kind of, I'm all about personal growth. And so obviously the Thailand thing was kind of following my intuition. But before I moved to Asia, I was actually kind of afraid of Asian culture. Like, I thought it was going to be very communal. I thought everyone was going to be like one and the same. Like, I don't know what, like my perception of things was so skewed. And so I really wanted to like broaden my horizons and learn more and like step into that. And I'm so glad I did, because it was definitely not anything like what the media makes it seem. Every culture is so different. And so, yeah, I've definitely learned a lot, but Japan was not on my radar. And I know it is, some people really love Japan, but for me, it was kind of just how things fell into place.
And the language, you've only been there a little bit. How was the language for you? Can you get around a little bit?
Japanese is very difficult. So you have to be really intentional about learning it. I just know basic words because I work at a kindergarten here. So the kids, they're really cute and it's really fun. I just teach basic English. So I don't have to know a ton, but here in Sapporo, there is not a lot of English speakers. So you do have to use a translator or learn the language. What's really popular in Japan is the JET program. So there's a lot of English speakers that will go to like remote villages or remote cities rather if they're in the JET program. And usually they kind of catch on easier because there's not as many English speakers around. But if you're living in the city, You can get around if you don't know English, if you have a translator or like a like Google on your phone. And a lot of the like public transportation systems do have English translation. And then here in Sapporo, there's a helpline for people that don't speak Japanese, because you can't really schedule like doctor's appointments or anything like that without a Japanese speaker. So there definitely are some roadblocks if you don't speak Japanese. So you have to make some network here. It's different than like Thailand or maybe somewhere else in Asia.
That's interesting. I didn't know that. Also, the Japanese culture, I guess, is similar to most Asian cultures, very passive. There's not a, I know they're, you know, the young Japanese are more hip to the Western ways, but the older ones, is it true that the older Japanese are more looked upon, more respected, being an older, the older generation? Is that true in Japan?
Yeah, I can go into that a little bit. So it's very common here that if you get married, you then live in a home with your husband's parents. And so the way things go here is they have about 25 years for each home, and then they like tear them down. It's very customary. So basically whenever you get married, usually you like build a new home and then you move in with your they like stay upstairs and you stay downstairs or whatever. So with in Tokyo right now, a lot of people actually aren't getting married because they're moving to Tokyo and they're like, I don't want to be a part of this culture anymore. I don't want to, you know, live with my husband's parents my whole life and do this thing. So a lot of young women and men actually aren't getting married. So that's like a big problem for Japan right now, is they're not getting married, they're not having kids, and they're working a lot. So yeah, and then here in Sapporo, it's a little bit different. So I'm kind of remote from the mainland, but I do live in a city of 2 million. People here do get married, they do have children. There's a lot of like biracial, not a lot, but there's some biracial families here of like foreigners and Japanese women, but the work ethic here is very strong. People work 10 plus hours a day. That's really intense. They're very, very into their jobs. They're very intentional with that. I'd say the biggest cultural shifts would be, one, people moving to Tokyo and not like having children as young as they used to. Two, would probably be like the cuisine. Like the traditional Japanese cuisine is very, very healthy. It's like one of the healthiest diets in the world. But you can go to like certain restaurants here that have a lot of fried foods, and there's like fast food restaurants now. And so I'd be interested to see how like this generation of children, if they're going to still be the same, like, you know, lean like stature, or if that's going to change in the next like 20 years. But yeah, I'd say the cultural shifts are probably people not getting married now and the food.
Well, that's really interesting. So, I mean, do you see, I don't know, a disadvantage for a single woman moving there as opposed to, say, someone like yourself that has a partner?
Yeah, so I think it depends on like your perception of Japan and what you're looking for. So for me, if I was here without a partner, like the startup costs moving to Japan are very, very high. So if you're not going with like a company or through the JET program, it can be very difficult. So like, for example, when I moved to Thailand, I got a job right away. I lived right outside of Bangkok, like 20 minutes outside, like on the outskirts. So I got paid a little bit more. I could move into an apartment right away. And it was a really low deposit. It was like $500 versus here, to move into an apartment, you have to either have like a Japanese translator, you have to pay, and this isn't anywhere in Japan. And so this is something a lot of people don't know about. You have to pay usually it's like as a gift, whoever you're renting from, you pay them 1 month's rent. So it's not a security deposit, it's like a gift. You also have to pay usually a cleaning fee, which is like half a month's rent. If you're a foreigner, you also have to pay a guarantor fee. And so it can be really expensive, and they're not usually furnished. They don't come with washers, they don't come with fridges, and they don't come with stoves. So you're responsible for paying all of that upfront if you do decide to come to Japan. The other option, if you're in a larger city, there's usually share homes. So if you do want to move somewhere like Tokyo, it's a little bit more doable, but you're not going to have like privacy, and it's still gonna be very expensive. So yeah, if you don't have that set up for you, it can be kind of difficult. And then as far as being a woman and setting all that up, I guess it's different for me because I moved here in the middle of a pandemic. So there's not as many foreigners here on the island. But when I was in Kyoto, there was a lot more foreigners. So yeah, it just depends what you're doing here. If you're moving here because you really want to teach English and you're super excited about learning about the culture for a year, then I think you'd be okay as a single woman. But you know, if you have something else in mind, I definitely think a lot of people fantasize and idealize Japan, and it's just a different place like anywhere else.
Well, that's good to know. So what other jobs do you think foreigners would be qualified for besides, I mean, if unless you're a digital nomad, but besides teaching English, are there any other traditional jobs the Japanese hire foreigners for?
Yeah, so the other big thing would be like tourist areas. There's a lot of people in like the service industry and like hotels. So I live really close to Niseko, which is a very famous ski town here in Japan. It's like a resort style town. And I actually met here, I'm friends with this girl that's from France. And she's done this thing before where you, when you work for these large corporations abroad, they actually like house you. So for like a certain rate, you can stay, usually they have some sort of village or like a part of the hotel that's like for people that are working for the hotels. So if you're really just wanting to like, you know, do something right after college or whatever, that's totally an option. Usually like a lot of places, like I'd say probably like Hilton or Marriott. I think that's, she worked for one of those. So yeah, you can work in a major resort town at a hotel. You can do some restaurants that are bilingual will hire you, and then teaching. The other way to come into Japan is if you have a certain amount of money saved, you can get a long-term cultural visa. Or if you get sponsored by like a dojo or for a certain cultural activity, you can also stay in Japan for a year.
Oh, okay. So there are several different ways you can come there. So is this going to be your home base? Are you here for the long term? Are you planning on doing some more travel around?
Yeah, so basically, when I moved to Japan, like I said, it was kind of in the middle of everything with COVID. And so because I decided not to do the consulting job, I actually started my own coaching business. So I've been doing that for a few months now. And I'm planning to move to Bali next year is my goal. So my contract finishes up here March 31st. So I will have been in Japan for a year. I moved here because I just really wanted to learn about like, I would see Japanese architecture. For me, it wasn't like anime or this like this lifestyle, but it was really the architecture. And so you find bits and pieces of that here. But I think, you know, the biggest thing I do is I try not to make presumptions before I move anywhere. I just kind of go there and see what's happening. But like you said, like this is really important to know like what the actual logistics of that process look like. So yeah, I'm hoping to do some traveling in April and May. If borders are open, I'm going to go to India and get my yoga certification and then go home for a little bit before moving to Bali for 6 months, I think is my plan. Yeah.
So you're going to be a nomad, basically. That's for the foreseeable future. You're just going to have the wanderlust and just travel around. Is that part of the world your favorite part to visit? I know you mentioned Africa. That you had wanted to originally go there, but are you pretty much going to concentrate in that area?
So I actually love Central America and South America. I really, really love Hispanic and Latin culture. So before I moved to Asia, I'd been to Honduras and Medellin, Colombia. So in college, I worked with students in Honduras and I'd help build schools there. And then I went to a spiritual retreat in Medellin. So I would love to get back out there, but just being on this side of the world and the community that I want to be a part of is in Bali right now. So I just figured, you know, when you talk to people, a lot of times, like there's a few things that they say they regret. And one of them is I wish I traveled when I was younger, is always a big one. And so while I'm at this age, I'm 24 now. So I moved abroad when I just turned 23 and I traveled a little bit before that, but you know, I'm sure like this will speak to a lot of women. It's like, sometimes if you grew up in like a small town and you move to a larger city, you know, I'd always kind of ventured out. I'd had friends that had lived abroad that were from abroad, international students. A lot of my friends growing up were from like other countries. You know, I had a lot of different friend groups, but I never really experienced travel in that way. I just traveled around the US. And so I never really thought like that was possible for me. And moving to a big city and meeting all these people who had been, I've been to 25 countries, and like DC is this really ambitious place. I was like immediately in this scene and connected with people that were, you know, doing really cool things. And so I was like, you know what, I want to do these really cool things and I want to experience it. And I'm going to do what I need to do to be able to experience this while I'm young. And so, yes, for now, the community, the coaching community, and the people that I want to be around are in Bali. And I really want to have community. And after that, I'm hoping to get my master's in cognitive science and then probably move back to the States after that. So I'll be, you know, later 20s by then.
Well, that's amazing. Did your family give you any pushback in the beginning? I mean, was there any doubts or fear in their minds when you first ventured out? That's a question a lot of women like to hear others say. Oh, did your family or your friends say, no, Jasmine, don't do it, don't go?
So I guess I'm really lucky. I have a pretty supportive family. So there's pros and cons to that, right? So I kind of can get, because I take risks and because I'm really intentional and I always try to work for things, my family recognizes that. And so they're usually really supportive with what I do. But actually, you know, going off that, since I've been abroad, I've been financially independent. So I know that can be kind of a lot. So in the past, I had just graduated. I did have some financial support from my grandparents every once in a while if I needed something, but I was paying most of my expenses on my own. And I know that's very common, you know, I guess that goes along with that. So before I moved abroad, I had a sales job and I had like a big commission check. And so I saved that to move abroad. And then my grandparents helped me with my TEFL certification. So they were supportive in that way because at the time I was just going through like a really big phase in life, right? Like my beginning life crisis. I was a year out of college. I was not sure what I wanted to do. And I realized that I needed to make a big change. So moving abroad for me was like kind of a, well, before that, it was like the catalyst to all of this and has allowed me a lot of growth during this year abroad and kind of getting to see things from a different perspective and shift.
Well, I love this story, and I'm so happy to have had the opportunity to talk with you. And most of the people that I talk with are older adults who've had, you know, been around the block a few times and had experience, but to see a young woman, young 24 out here living and thriving abroad, it's really a joy to see. And I hope that others that are, you know, in the same type of a situation where they're young and not knowing what to do, that, you know, just hearing your story will let them know that, hey, you know, if I did it, you can do it too. And there's always where there's a will, there's a way. Now, your coaching, is there a way that others can contact you for coaching in case you'd like to offer your services to anyone watching?
Yeah, so my website's jasminelancaster.com, and I focus on helping women change their habits, embrace change. Obviously, I've been through a lot of changes and step into a new reality. So I help with transitional coaching. I do relationship coaching, stress management, all of those things. And I'm a certified NLP practitioner. So you can find me at jasminelancaster.com. And I also have Instagram. It's The Natural Being.
My goodness, all of that in packed into that little 24-year-old. I'm so excited for you. That's amazing. Well, we'll put the link for you in the bottom of the video. But I would like to say a big thank you so much for sharing your story with us. You're an amazing woman, and I hope that you will continue to do amazing things in your life. Thank you so much.
Nice talking.
Bye-bye.
Bye.